ओके सो गुड इवनिंग गाइज, वेलकम टू द नॉलेज सेशन. माय नेम इज गिरीश भारती एंड आई एम सॉफ्टवेयर कंसल्टेंट हियर. सो टुडे लाइक वी आर गोइंग टू हैव अ सेशन ऑन अक्का रिमोटिंग. सो दीज आर सम नॉलेज सर्टिफिकेट्स. सो आई वुड लाइक रिक्वेस्ट यू टू गो थ्रू देम एंड ट्राई टू फॉलो देम ड्यूरिंग द नॉलेज सेशन. सो दैट विल बी वेरी हेल्पफुल फॉर ऑल ऑफ अस. So for today, this is the agenda. We are going to talk about what is Akka Remoting and the Akka Remoting capabilities, and what are the features provided by Akka Remoting, and the challenges faced by Akka Remoting, and how we can enable Akka Remote in our application, and then we are going to see a small demo for the Akka application, which will be using Akka Remoting as a solution of the problem. So let's begin with what is remoting. So I think every one of us have heard about the term the remote working, right? So every one of us know what remote working is. So how many of you have heard about remote working? Just
people
contact each other across the network. Okay, so yes, you are correct, right? So remote working is kind of everyone is working from remote locations and they are communicating with each other and working on just one task, one project, and then this is how the things goes on. So Akka Remoting is also very similar to that in my kind of views. So if you talk about the Akka Remoting, so Akka Remote is basically a module provided by Akka. So we all have, so I think most of us have used the Akka Actor module within Akka. So Akka basically is a toolkit which comes up with various libraries and various features. So Akka Remote is one of the feature of Akka. So it is kind of feature that is provided by Akka. So if we talk about the what Akka Remoting is as a definition, so we can say that the Akka Remote module which provide an elegant solution for communicating between actors across networks are called Akka Remoting. So we all know the applications which are running on single systems and only one node is responsible for running one application. But what if we want to scale our application across different nodes and across clusters? So that is the use case where actually Akka Remote comes in picture. So we all know about scaling up and scaling out capabilities. So in today's world, we need applications that can scale with increasing load. So Akka Remoting also provide this kind of features. So if we talk about Akka Remoting, so if there are multiple actor systems, so Akka Remoting is kind of beginning of the advanced topics in Akka. So before going into Akka Remoting, I think all of us should have some basic knowledge of what Akka is and how it works, the basics of actor models provided by Akka. So I'm assuming that every one of us are having that basic knowledge what Akka is and how Akka works. So we must have idea about how the actor system works and what is the actor model followed by Akka. So if we have multiple actor systems that are running on different nodes and we want to communicate among those actors, so this actor system has this actor, and if you want this actor to communicate with another actor within another actor system or another node, you can say, then how can we do that? So Akka Remoting basically provide this functionality so that one actor on one node can communicate with the other actor on another node. So if we talk about The use cases of Akka remoting. So there are a lot of use cases. As you can see, like there is a huge list of use cases where the Akka remoting is being used. So if we talk about like the transaction processing systems, then like we have online gaming, finance, banking, trading, statistics, and a lot of things. Similarly, like if you talk about the service backends, then any industry and any application can use like the Akka remoting depending on use cases. So if we want to provide concurrency and parallelism, then again like there are many use cases of Akka remote. Similarly, like for the simulations of kind of master worker simulation as well, where like we have one master and many workers that are basically performing the actual task. So very similar to like how this Spark works. So it has basically one driver and multiple workers. So the work is distributed among the workers and it gets performed. So that kind of simulations can also be achieved by Akka remote. So similarly for like the batch processing and communication hub, gaming and betting. So these are some of the use cases where Akka remote can be used and being used right now. So if you talk about the Akka remoting capabilities, so basically Akka provide a lot of things and Akka remoting is one of them. So Akka remoting also provide Akka cluster, Akka cluster sharding and a lot of things. So basically if you talk about how they are different, so they are kind of interrelated but provide different kind of features for different kind of use cases. So if you talk about the capabilities specific to Akka remote, so this is a kind of list which is provided by Akka remote. So as you can see, like we have location transparency with remote actor ref, then we have remote addressing, remote messaging, remote deployment and multiple network transport. So these are some of the capabilities that Akka remote add to our application. So let's go through them one by one. So if you talk about location transparency, so can anyone have idea what location transparency is? I mean in real world as well. Anyone else? Okay, so as a real life example, if we need to communicate with any person across the world, then what is the minimum requirement we have for communicating with someone? Yes, possibly just a phone number, right? So we don't really need to take care of the actual location of the person. But we just need a phone number and we can communicate with any of the person across the world, right? So this is kind of example of location transparency. So we don't really care about the physical location, but still we can communicate. And communicate just like we are talking face to face, right? So it was about kind of the real world example of location transparency. In Akka remote, if you talk about location transparency, that is very similar. So we can have multiple actors across our actor system. So let's say we have application running on our local system with one actor system and multiple actors within it. So all the actors can communicate with each other within an actor system by actor ref, right? So if we need to go out of the border and we need to communicate with an actor that is located at some other place, then communicating with a local actor and communicating with a remote actor should be very similar, right? So in Java, like Java RMI also works in that fashion. So in Java RMI, like we can calculate, we can basically call a function like it is currently in on local system, but it actually is not on local system. Instead, it is on server side, right? So just like Java RMI, the Akka remote works. In Akka remote, if you are talking about location transparency, then we should be able to write code that we can communicate with actor across clusters, right? So in Akka remote, like most of the things are dependent on configuration, and you can just change your configuration file a bit, and you can directly communicate with the across the cluster. So this is kind of feature that Akka remote provide, and how we do that, we are going to see it on next few slides, like how actually we can communicate across the cluster. So here you can see like the Akka remote actor ref. So this remote actor ref is basically an internal API of Akka remote that is basically required to communicate with actors that are actually on different locations. So how this API is used, again, like we are going to see in next few slides. So before like moving into that, does anyone have any query till here? So let's move to the next thing. So the next capability provided by Akka is remote addressing. So if an actor is running on our local system, then we can easily find out where it is running, right? So for a local system, so we know like for Akka actor system, the actor contain an actor path, which actually define the absolute path of actor, right? So here, like you can see, this is our actor system, and actor system comes up with a guardian supervisor for user. So all the user created actors are basically child of this guardian supervisor, and then we have this some supervisor parent class, and within this actor it can contain its child classes. So this is kind of creating an hierarchy of different actors, right? But on the root, we have this guardian supervisor user defined actors, and there is one more supervisor that is system, which is basically supervising the system generated actors. So if we talk about the actor path, this is kind of the actor path for remote actor. So we have this protocol specified here, and this actor system name, and then the host of the actor, then port, and then this is the complete path. So this actor basically defines the it is a child of parent, and the parent is child of user in case of like the child actor. So if you talk about the remote addressing, so the remote address, so this address basically consists of the protocol and the actor name, the IP or the host name of the server where the remote actor is currently running on, and the port of the server, right? So what is the role of host and port, we will be looking in further slides. So we have already talked about this actor path. So you know, like within an actor system, each and every actor has an unique actor path, and we can identify each and every actor using that actor path. So any queries here up till now? Okay. So here you can see, like if we are talking in terms of local actor system, then the actor part looks like this. So this is Akka. If we are not using Akka remote and or Akka cluster or anything else which which can communicate across the cluster. And if we are running actor system on our local machine only, or on single node, then the actor path looks like this. So it contains the protocol, which is ACCA by default, and then we have this actor system name, which is necessary for starting an actor system, and then we have this this absolute path for the actor. So if we talk about the address in terms of remote actors, then it slightly changes. So after the actor, so we have this protocol here, and this protocol is basically the transport protocol, which will be used to basically communicate with the remote actors. And then we have this actor system. So this is the name of actor system for which we want to communicate with the actor. And this is kind of the host address, and then port, and this is the again the absolute path of the actor on remote machine. So running ACCA actor system on local and on remote communication, this is one of the slight difference that comes into picture. And the next thing is during ACCA remote, so one of the tasks is how to handle remote messaging. So if you want to communicate with actors on a different node, then how we are going to send a message to that actor. So ACCA remoting solves this issue, and using ACCA remote you can communicate with any actor just you are communicating within local system, right? So this is one of the feature provided by ACCA remoting. So how it is used, we will be looking in further slides. So similarly, there is one more thing which ACCA remote provide, and that is actor deployment. So in ACCA, if you want to deploy one actor to other system from your local system, then you can also do that. So ACCA remote provide all of the functionalities for this. So if you want to deploy one actor on let's say you have a scenario where you are using one master node, and then you want to distribute your work across different workers, and you want to deploy your workers on demand. So if there is a new work assigned, then only you want to deploy actor on the remote machine and perform the task there, you can also do that. So ACCA remote also provide remote deployment, and how it is provided, we will be looking further in slides. So No. So ACCA remote basically provide an abstraction. So it looks like the actor is deploying on the kind of local system, but it doesn't. The actual actor will be deployed on the remote machine, not on current system. So this deployment will work on kind of the message passing system. So you will be passing a deploy message, and the actual actor would be creating on the remote machine only. Proxy type, yes, you can say. So there are various classes provided by ACCA remote, and all this task is handled by ACCA internally. So what actually happened is it will ping the remote system to create a new actor, and one important and necessary thing is that actor jar should be provided to the remote actor system. So you basically give a class path there, and then on demand the remote actor system will be deploying that actor. So how it will happen, we are going to see it in demo as well. It will be more helpful for you to understand it. So for actor deployment, yes, it is. So you must have the same code base, at least the class of actor you want to deploy on remote machine.
Exactly same code base, that class should be present.
Yes, that class should be present there. Yeah, so while creating a new vector, you basically give a class of parameter, right? So you basically give a class path, then it basically picks the vector from there. Yes. Yeah, so we are going to talk about it in further slides, but yes, it works like just like the message passing system, and like the messages will be like traveling from one system to other system using NETI or the TCP protocol. So we are going to talk about that. Okay, so the next thing is like multiple network transports. So basically, you know, communicating two nodes with each other. But one of the necessary thing is kind of a transport layer, so that like messages can be passed from one system to other system, and to the kind of required location or the specific actor. So that task is basically done by so internally Akka is capable of running your transport with multiple protocols. So one of the most used protocol is TCP. So TCP is basically used to communicate with like two vector systems or node, you can say. TCP is a connection oriented protocol, but if you want to use UDP, you can do that, and if you want to use SSL, you can also do that. So SSL is kind of a more secure kind of protocol. So if you want to include more security for this communication, then you can also go for that. And again, like if you want to use your own defined protocols, then you can also do that. So now let's talk about Akka remoting features. So if you talk about like what are the features of Akka, then it is distributed by default, and then we will be talking about like the age in which the transparency is broken, and what are the communication gap between system, and what wrong can occur. Then we will be talking about like how is remoting used within applications. Then peer-to-peer versus client-server architecture. So then like marking points of scaling up with routers. Similarly, like you are right now doing on your local systems, if you have already worked on. So then how can we scale up our processing with our routers on local, on remote systems? So if you talk about like the distributed by nature, so basically, there was a white paper written by Jim Waldo, Jeff Patton, around 1994, and the title was "A Note on Distributed Computing." So at that time, like the distributed computing was kind of being evolved. So this white paper basically contained some very useful approaches for designing distributed systems. So in this white paper, like the writer has mentioned a lot of useful things for distributed system designs, but one of the most important thing is like there are two ways of designing distributed systems. So one way is to design your system to work on local machine, and then change it in order to like work on remote communications. So the other approach is basically thinking in terms of remote communications, and then kind of implementing your local interactions. So Akka basically follows the second approach. So Akka always thinks in terms of distributed computing. So first of all, like each and every Akka thing is distributed. So you can distribute each and everything. So that's why like Akka is kind of distributed in nature, and you can communicate communicate across the cluster, or you can scale out things very, very similarly, like you can do it with a single system. So all the interaction of vector are purely message passing, and everything is asynchronous. So in Akka, like the actor model works on kind of message passing asynchronously. So there are kind of side effects if we lose this paradigm. So we should be always following this paradigm. Our all communications should be asynchronous, because if we are going across the cluster, then some network latency can be there as well. So the messages can take more time, and that. So the best way to handle this kind of interaction is making them asynchronous. So now let's talk about the ways in which transparency is broken. So one of the important thing is, like, all the messages which we are sending through this wire with TCP protocol or any other protocol, they should be serializable. So ultimately, like, on your transport layer, only your bytes can move from one end to other end. So in Akka as well, like, your message should be serializable. So the Akka remote and even the all the Akka comes up with default Java serialization, but there are many drawbacks of Java serialization, because it is kind of one of the way of keeping a lot of unnecessary data. Even your XML is smaller than your Java serialization. So you know, like, right now one of the best way to pass transport your data is kind of the JSON format, and if we compare the JSON format with XML, then we find XML is having a lot of extra tags within it, and we find it kind of bulky in comparison to JSON. But the Java serialization, it creates a pretty huge payload, and that is really very bulky, and that basically reduces your performance. But in terms of, like, Akka, all the messages should be serializable. If you are trying to pass anything that is not serializable, your location transparency can be broken. So it can work on your local system, but not on your remote interaction. So the next point is, like, everything needs to be aware of all interactions being fully asynchronous. So again, like, the this asynchronicity of your application, that plays a very crucial part, because the time consumption on your local system and your remote system can vary. So while communicating with remote system, you may feel network latency and slower response in comparison to, like, your local system. So that's why, like, the transparency can be broken. And if we talk in terms of the loss of data within a single JVM, then in comparison to remote interaction, that is pretty less. Again, like, it's not 100%. I mean, if you are running a single JVM, then there is a very less possibility, which is very close to zero, like, your messages will be lost. But again, it's not completely zero. There are possibilities that some of the messages will be lost within a single JVM as well. But if you compare it with remote interactions, then that is pretty less. So in remote interaction, there is a more possibility that your messages can lost. Any question till now? Yes. So in Java serialization, like, most of the objects are serializable, but if there is any object which is not serializable in terms of like the complex objects, then there is a possibility that you must be kind of give your own serializer for that. So that depends, but you should not be facing a problem with most of the objects or classes while passing messages. Yes, so it uses standard Java serializer, but soon like they are kind of going to deprecate it. So it's always a good practice to write your own serializers and provide your own serializer. And they have recently launched one more new you can say, I think it's Notool Artery or something like that. That will be using their own serializers, and they are going to remove Java serializer completely from that. So are you heavy? Yes, you can do that. I mean, you can give your you can use protobuf as well. So for serializers as well, it is totally dependent on your configuration. You can give your own serializers, even a combination of different serializers. You can use Java serializer as well as protobuf and your JSON serializer as well. So you can just configure it on the configuration file. Anyone else? Okay. So let's move further. So the next thing is like how Okka remoting works on the applications actually. So from here, like we are looking in terms of implementation, how we are going to implement Okka remoting. So Okka remote. So the Okka remoting is most of the Okka remoting is configuration driven. So you can just use your configurations to basically deploy your actors on local systems or as well as on remote systems. So while doing that, like you can scale your application without actually touching your code, and this is kind of one of the very easy feature that is provided by Okka remote. So most of the things are happening internally and driven by Okka itself, but you just need to mention like how you want to deploy your actors or like how things gonna work. So there is one exception as well. While deploying your actors on a remote machine, then there is one more feature provided, and you can basically control it with your code. But that is again like that also comes up with the configuration, and you can do it with configuration as well as your code. So the next thing is like peer-to-peer and the client-server architecture. So I think most of us have some idea about what is a client-server architecture and what is a peer-to-peer network. So basically this first diagram, so it is a client-server architecture. As you can see, like there is one server and multiple clients. So multiple clients are requesting so they are sending requests to the server, and server is basically responding them back. Unlike it, like the peer-to-peer network, so you can see there is communication between each and every node, and you can see each and every node has a direct connection with other nodes. Right? So this is kind of peer-to-peer network, and the Okka follows this architecture. So in Okka, like if you have three nodes, then each and every node can communicate with each other. So for being a peer-to-peer system, so these are two conditions. So if a system A can connect to system B, then system B must also be able to connect to system A. So it's kind of duplex communication. So if there are two nodes, A and B, then node A should be able to communicate with node B, and the vice versa, node B should be able to communicate with node A. And the next thing is like as it happens in master slave architecture or the client server architecture, one node is basically receiving their requests, and the other nodes are basically initiating the request. So unlike that, like in peer to peer system, both nodes should be able to do both the things. So this is the next feature of Akka remoting. So if you want to scale your performance with routers, you can do that using just configuration. So if you want, so I think we all of us have some idea about how the router works and how they provide parallelism for the request. So a router basically, it can contain the configurable number of routers. So these routers are again they are actors, and this router basically pass the request to different actors, and we can, and the routers can process multiple messages parallelly, and it basically helps in scaling your application or the parallelization. So using Akka remoting, by making changes into configuration, you can basically create a new router out of the actor. So this is kind of configuration we can use to deploy the routers. So as you can see, like we have this processor actor defined, and it is kind of router which has provided round robin pool with number of instances 100 and with the target nodes. So this is kind of way, and if we will kind of remove these two things, then it is going to create just a single actor. So how actually we can tweak with this configuration, we can have a look into it while demoing the code. But right now, like what you can understand out of it is like by changing few lines in configuration, you can deploy an actor as well as a router with the same code, and you are not making any changes into your code. So actually, so there are many things. So we have Akka remote, then we have Akka clusters, then we have Akka cluster sharding. So these are kind of different tools provided by Akka. So if we talk in terms of what challenges Akka remoting solves, then we get these points. So basically the responsibility of Akka remoting is to take care of how to address actor system living on remote hosts. So basically identifying the actor paths and addresses. So that is the job of Akka remote. Then how to address individual actors on remote actor system, that is again job of Akka remote. And how to turn messages bytes into the wire, so the serialization of messages, that is also done by Akka remote. Then the low level managements, the network connections between host, and the crashes, and how to handle all these things transparently, that is kind of responsibility of Akka remote. So if we talk about how to enable Akka remote in your application, then here are some of the steps to do that. So what we need to do is just need to add dependency for Akka module. So basically this is kind of Akka actor, and you can also run your Akka applications without dependency specific to Akka remote. So if you just want to use your actor system with actors running on your local machine, then you can use this library. And if you want to go across JVMs, then you can use this extra module which is Akka remote, and it is also provided by Akka. So the next thing is basically configuring remote actor ref provider. So okay, so this configuration, remote actor ref provider, we need to provide it on the configuration file. So let me just try to see if we have, So here, so within your Akka configurations, you need to give it a remote if you are using single JVM application right now. Then you must find it as local. So that local local provider is used when you want to use single JVM for your application. If you want to use more than one JVMs for your application, then you can just change it to remote. And internally, what it does, it will create a new instance of remote actor ref, which is the internal API provided by Akka remote, and which is basically responsible for handling all the communication that will happen out of the out of the current JVM. So the next step is to basically enable at least one transport. So how this communication will be happening during runtime of application, we need to define that. So as I already mentioned, like there are many protocols. So here, like this is the way to do that. We have to enable transports, and here we have this native TCP. So if you want to enable TCP protocol, then we can do this. And the native TCP basically require two configurations. One is hostname and the other is port. So it basically implies that your remote application would be listening on this port. So as in WebSockets, we basically have a server and we can start it on a specific port. It is almost similar to that. So it will basically start listening at this port. So any other application or node which want to communicate with this node or this JVM application, then that can do it using this port. So how it will happen, we will be talking more on it. But right now, like it was about the configuration and how we are enabling Akka remote in our application. So it was about this part, like enabling at least one transport for your application. Now what we have done is, like, we have added the dependency of Akka remote in our application. Then the next thing we have done is, like, we have changed the provider for the application. So now the provider is remote, and we will be having a reference of Akka remote Akka ref. So after that, like, we have also defined the transport for our application. So now we have TCP as a transport protocol. So the next thing is, like, configuring address for each transport. So as I have already mentioned, we have to define the host name and the port of the application so that we can initiate a inbound connection on that port. So the last thing is, like, start your actor system. So once your actor system is start, it will create remote actor ref, and that will initiate a new inbound connection on the port specified on the configuration file, and then it will start listening on that port. Yes, by default. So I think I'm not sure about it, but I think Spark was also started with Akka remote, and they were using it initially. But after some of their versions, they removed Akka remote, and they directly used the native. So basically, they wanted to get more control over threads, so that's why they did that. But this is also kind of abstraction over native. So Akka remote internally provide TCP protocol for that. So I think we have already talked about this. Then this is kind of four most important parts of Akka remoting. So the transport, as we already know, like it is a communication protocol, how your systems going to communicate with each other. So we have already talked about different protocols for it. So we have, like, TCP by default, and we can also use UDP, which is connectionless protocol, but that requires some more efforts within the code as well for the communication. And we have SSL. So which is more secure in comparison to TCP and UDP. So now the next thing is addresses. So if you want to communicate to an actor which is running on remote system, we must need the address of that actor. So until and unless we have the address of that actor, we won't be able to communicate with that. Yes. So the next thing is endpoint. So by the endpoint, we mean like the host and port of the remote JVM or the node, you can say, where the actor system is running. And then the association. So this association is the link that will create after the first communication of two JVMs, you can say. So we will be talking more on associations, but right now you can think of it as the TCP communication, which is actually responsible for the communication between different actors while your application is running. So we have already seen it. I think we can skip it now. So any question till here? Anybody have any queries or questions right now? So both are possible. You might have an actor already running on remote system, and that can be used by actor selection. So we are going to see two different ways for Akka remote. So one of the ways, like you can communicate with the actor which is already running on remote system, and the other way is to initiate a deployment on remote system. Yes, so we can do both the things. Yes, of course. So but the most important thing is, like, with the configuration only you can deploy a router instead of single actor on the remote machine.
So,
it should be able to provide all kind of routing algos that are available with Akka. So while creating a router with your code, if you can provide the routing algo there, then you can also provide it with the router. So it's a part of configuration. You can configure it while creating a router. Yes, so it must have information of remote actors, at least the actor path, so that it can communicate. But sorry, could you please repeat your question again? Yes. So routing in terms of, like, if you are talking about the Akka router, so Akka router basically it kind of provide an interface between a group of actors. So within if you are sending a message to a router, that means you are sending a message to kind of an actor F that will forward them to different actors according to the routing algo you are providing. So the use case you are talking about, if you want to basically load your balance and kind of provide smart routing. So you can, I think possibly you can do that with your customized algos for that. But if you don't want to do that, Akka comes up with Akka cluster sharding that also provide load balancing with various shards running on different nodes. And if you want to kind of again find the best node to run your to basically deploy your work on, so then you can probably tweak your code a bit, I think, so that like you can keep track of all the nodes and the current tasks they are processing. So there are various ways, but that will depend on your use case. But if you want to do things more in more abstraction, then Akka cluster sharding would be, I think, one of the possible region without tweaking a code a bit. Any other questions?
How Akka identifies this node have a minimum number of values? This node have this matrices?
Yeah, because this is the entry. So, say, last the execution have to deploy an order. Then you can define the configuration around the case of what you have decided where to deploy. For example, if you have a CPU user, right? In that case, it gets the cigar data from all the different nodes.
So should we move? Okay, so this is basically kind of the flowchart, what happens when to kind of remote the two JVMs start with Akka remoting. So I'm taking an example of kind of client server architecture. So this is kind of application where we have one client and client, or you can say a master, and which is basically asking the other node to do the job for it. So when it starts, when the actor system starts on client, so it basically opens and inbound TCP endpoint port on port 0. So in your configuration, if you haven't defined any port for your application, then it will start it on the OSL, the operating system selected port. and then it will start listening for it and wait for the incoming associations. So similarly, in terms of a server, so here, like if you have configured the node, because like you will be taking it as a worker, so it is necessary to basically define an inbound host and port for it. So if you have done that, so it will basically start an inbound TCP connection on port 8081. So after that, like it will start listening on that port. So the point to be noticed is like on both the applications, or you can say on both the actor systems or on both the nodes, both will start listening on a configurable port, right? So this thing happens next. So if system one says I want to connect to you, then it will send an outbound message to system two. Then system two will accept this message, and basically a two-way handshake happens here, and it will send an inbound message to system one. So once this two-way handshake happens, then basically a link is created. A TCP connection is created between system one and system two. So this is how basically the two-way handshake happens. So from system one, like the actor wants to send a message to this specific actor. So this actor is basically defined on system two, and then it will open a new outbound endpoint and a new outbound endpoint will be started on a random port, and the message will be sent to system two, and it will receive a handshake from system one, and it will accept an inbound association from system one, and then send a associate message to system two, and the connection will be established. So this is kind of the steps that will be followed for basically initiating a connection, or we call it association between two nodes. So once the association is done between two nodes, then all the actors can communicate very similar to like they were communicating within a single JVM. So this is kind of, again, the association process that happens. User-defined actors, so it basically wants to send a message to system two, and it sends, it will check no available endpoint to system two. It will check whether we already have an association to system two or not. So if there is no association available, then it will send association to system two, and then it will receive associate, and it will basically accept the inbound request and send an associate, and then the communication on both the nodes will be open. So once the communication is open, this is kind of remote actor path, and using this absolute path, actors on one system can communicate with actors on other system. So we just need to take care of this path. So once it is done, the things will start working like they are running on single JVM only. So there are two types of ACCA remote interactions. So one is lookup. So as we have already talked a bit about it, the lookup is basically used to look up an actor that is already deployed on actor 2. And the second is actor creation or deployment. So if the actor is not created on a remote system, then we can do this. So we can also deploy actor from our local to the remote system. So let's see this in action and how it happens. So this is kind of use case I'm using for the demo purpose only. So this is a kind of application which basically works on Akka HTTP, this is an Akka HTTP application, and it will be working like a master. So it will be accepting the request or the query request from the users, and it will basically pass them to different workers. So this is a kind of application that basically calculates the runtime population, and all over the world, like there can be various countries, and there can be various servers, and they must be like interacting, or they are keeping track of, they will be like keeping track of the population increment each and every time. So instead of like fetching information from different cities or different countries at one location, what we can do is like we can distribute the entire geolocations into different parts and deploy our application on their locality, so that like they can be like less network latency, and the queries can be faster, and we can just forward our queries from master to workers, and then workers can perform things for us. So this is kind of use case. So let's see some code in action. So is it visible to everyone? Okay, so let me show you some code. So this is basically a demo application, and I have kind of two modules. It's a multi-module project, so that basically contain two different modules. One is for the actor selection, and other is for actor deployment. So let me share. So first of all, like let me share the application itself. So let's talk about the actor selection first. So in my actor selection, as you can see, like here I have a master. So this master basically denotes the Akka HTTP application, which can accept the HTTP requests from clients, and that will basically pass them to worker for the actual processing. So this is the route defined for it, and this is basically my master. So here you can see, like, first of all, let me share the configuration for this application. So this is my configuration file, and here as I already mentioned, like we have the provider as remote. Here we have defined the transport, and here we have host name and port name. So right now, like we are going to run the application on single machine, so we need to change the port for it, because we can, so two application cannot run on same port. So that's why like this overwriting is happening here. Apart from it, like I have also defined the default dispatcher for the application. So it basically doesn't do a lot of things for Akka remoting work, but that is just to check the performance and just to control the parallel thread allocated to the application. So in my masters, what I have done is like I have created a new actor system, and I have used this system.actorSelection. So this actor selection is a function provided by the actor system, and it is basically used to look up an actor on remote system. So here you can see like I have to provide this absolute path for that specific actor. So this is kind of my local host. So I'm going to run my application on the local host and on port number 52552, and this is my actor path. So after that, like so this part is basically responsible for binding the Akka HTTP applications. So I'm passing this processor as this processor which contain actor selection, and it also works just like the actor ref. So it was all about the master. If we have a look into what an actor does, so here is like my actor application. So here what I'm trying to do is I'm creating an actor. So it is basically an actor router. So it was just to increase the performance. So it is an actor selection, so that's why like it is hard coded right now. So right now like it will create an actor router with 20 actor instances having round robin pool as the routing algo, and with the name processor. So right now on our worker JVM, we are basically creating a new actor ref with the name processor, which is actually of type actor router. So now let's try to run this code. Okay, so here I'm starting my master. And here I'm starting my worker. So basically two JVMs will be working on single machine. So as you have seen, like the actor system on worker has also started, and it has already created the actor router with 20 actors. So these actors are query processor actors. So just to test the behavior, I'm going to use Apache Parallel as a tool for concurrent request. So what I'm trying to do is like I have parallelly executed 20 requests for the master. So those requests will be here. So as you can see, like we got the requests here, and from master we basically passed them to the worker nodes, and the worker nodes executed those requests and sent back a response to master, and master basically send a response back to the users that are basically querying. So left-hand side. So from the postman, you can see like I'm hitting this URL, and it is basically initiating a request on my master node that is basically passing this request to workers, and we are getting a response back. So it was about the actor selection. So the next thing is the actor deployment. Okay, so the next thing is actor deployment. So if you look into the configuration for it, so here like we can see all the things very similar to the configuration file we saw for the first demo. So here like we have defined this. So this is for generating an actor router. So using this part we can create a router out of this actor. So here is one more sample. So if this configuration is provided, it is going to create a new actor, but with this configuration it will again create a router, and with 100 instances, and we can define the round robin pool. So if you talk about the application, here like this is my master, and this is the way to deploy the actor. So basically we are creating a new actor, so with the name processor, and this processor I'm defining it into my configuration file. So when the actor system gets the request of creating the processor, it will basically create it on remote system. And one more way to do it is from code. So as I already mentioned, like so there is the actor deployment part which we can control through code. So this is the way to do that. We have remote scope and address here, which is very similar to the thing we are doing here. Here we have from config and props. So both the things are going to do similar things. So let's start the application for remote deployment. Okay, so here like the master is starting for remote deployment. And this is my worker. So my master has started on localhost port 8081, and this my worker has also started, and it is ready to process work. But you must have noticed like there was no actor creation right now for the actor system. So let's try to query the master and try to see if it can deploy the actor on the node. So here like you see that here we got a request, and out of that request a new actor is deployed, which is basically a router having 100 nodes, and it basically process the query and send a response. So this is how kind of it works. And if we once the actor is created, it won't deploy again on the remote machine. So actors are unique. So this is for the first time the actor was deployed. For the next time, like it will use the same actor. So again, let's try to put some request, and it is able to process them. So these are some references. If you want to go deeper into Akka Remote, you can follow these links. And that's all for today. Thank you so much.